Hi, I'm Seth Farron. I'm doing my sales video. I'm going to be selling a mattress here at Sears. Okay, here we go. Let me come this way. Hi there.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Good.
I noticed you over here looking at mattresses. Do you have any questions or anything I can answer for you?
Yeah, I'm looking for a mattress. My parents are buying one for me and my husband for wedding present.
Okay. Well, first off, my name's Seth, and you are?
Tammy,
how are you?
Fine.
Okay, well, what are you looking for in a mattress?
Something that is firm, that's going to support my back.
Support your back? Okay, well, right now we have on sale here at Sears.
We
have this,
the
Simmons Beauty Rest. It's 58% off. This is about as firm as they come. Why don't you go ahead and get up there and lay on that.
This one's a little bit.
Is that a little too hard?
Yeah.
Now, are you having back problems? Is that what it is?
Yeah, I want something that's firm but comfortable.
Firm but comfortable? Okay. The reason why this is so firm is what they have is it's called a 13 gauge coil. It's one of the stiffest coils made, and it's throughout the entire mattress. Now, this mattress that we have right here, the Monarch, it's made by Spring Air. Basically, what it is, it's a little softer mattress, but what they've done is Spring Air has a contract with ambulance companies and places like that. They've made this for the backboards in ambulances. What it does is when you put your weight down on one area, it lifts the other area up to support the small of your back and the shoulders and the neck. So you're just completely, you know, it's just covering every part of your body. Go ahead and lay up there on that one for a minute. What do you think of that one? It is, isn't it? And another thing about Spring Air is they came out with what's called the open-ended coil, like I'll show you on this right here. Basically, they started the market on the open-ended coil, and since then, Sealy's come out with it. Basically, what it means with an open-ended coil is you have more room.
Shoppers, it's now 8:55. Our store will close in 5 minutes.
You can see that it's restricted to movement. This one, no matter which way you lay, since it's open, it has more freedom. Also, with the Spring Air coil is one of the best ones we have. I can show you this little demonstration right here. The middle one is the Spring Air coil.
Okay.
Somebody broke that. That's the Simmons coil, which is the bed you just laid on right here. And this is the old Sealy and Sears coil. And you can see it can push down. Which coil is stronger?
The Spring Air.
Yeah. As you can see there. So a lot of people will wonder, I want a mattress that has 700 coils in it. Now, this may not have 700 coils in it, but if you have a mattress with that many, three times the coils, as you can see, the Spring Air coil still is stronger than all three of those. So it's not really the quantity of coil that counts, it's the quality.
Okay. And what kind of warranties does this have on it?
Okay, this one has a 15-year non-prorated warranty, which basically means it covers the fabric, the foam underneath it, and the springs. Basically, in 5 years, you look at the mattress and you can see the indents in the mattress. It covers that. It covers natural wear and tear on the fabric. If you tear it on a nail, it's not going to cover that. But basically, most anything that goes wrong is covered on it. If it's the mattress's fault, if it's turned properly, and they say every time you change your sheets, you should turn the mattress.
Okay.
So. They did a study at a university on the Spring Air mattress. They studied every single mattress. They did over 1,000 mattresses. The Spring Air, this exact mattress with thermoform in it, the people that slept on that mattress turned 6 to 9 times during the night. Now, the next best one, they turned 60 to 90 times. So you can tell there's a big difference in quality between this one and the next best. What do you think?
I like it. Now, how soon could I get it?
Okay, now, Sears does have a policy. We have to order everything in from the warehouse. Mattresses are taking about 3 days. If you'd like it delivered to your house, there's a $30 fee for that, which is assessed on all furniture. But if you want to go ahead, I can take the numbers over to the register and pull it up and see if I can get it here for you.
Okay. All right, can you go ahead and do that?
Yeah. Right. Now, would you like to put this on your Sears charge?
Yeah.
Or yeah? Okay. All right.
A unique team in a unique position in a unique place and time in history. I'm Bill Marcroft, and I have the honor to conduct tonight's program, and it's a distinct pleasure for me because these are my boyhood heroes. Before we begin dinner, may I introduce our distinguished guests, the Golden Boys and their wives, in alphabetical order, Arnie Farron and Rolaine. Would you please stand?
Thank you. like to thank everyone for all their support that she's received the past year. At this time, she would like to dedicate this dance to someone special, to her that couldn't be here tonight, and also to her parents for their constant love and support. Miss Nicole Eagle. Congratulations to Mary Ann. Our second runner-up, Marie Van Camp. Congratulations to Marie. Our first runner-up is Wendy Jepson.
He's gonna be great when he goes to dances. Hey, baby, you wanna dance, huh? That's right. There we go. We're dancing. Go get mom. Go get mom.
You are so good at that. Where was his ride? He was gonna ride that swan.
Oh.
Say hi, Grandpa. Hey, Grandpa. Hello.
As I fall up the stairs.
Okay.
He doesn't need a car, he's got a swan.
Whoops. Wave at the people.
You gonna wave?
These are so cute.
They're so big. It's a bucking swan. He's in the rodeo. Oh, you're a cute boy. You're fun to play with, even though you're lost in there. You can do tricks.
Oh, he got his head on my head. Yes.
Oh, I had his head. He wasn't going anywhere.
Yes, there he is.
He's really filling out those overalls, isn't he?
Not quite sure about this, so we could try it this way. Peek-a-boo.
Let's see that wig.
He'll grow up and go, "Are you guys just bored or what?"
Rude.
Sit there and Oh, don't get it in his eyes. Oh, let me get a picture of him. That's funny.
It's one of the Beatles.
Wait a minute, get this out of your face. Hey, Mom.
Okay, hold that there. We gotta have all three props.
Oh, he's not gonna be able to handle it.
He says,
I don't think so.
Oh, shoot.
We're just being mean. He's not gonna like it. Never mind. Hey,
afterwards, and of course here you see Emily's successful people. You have three engineers, a teacher, a couple of doctors, and the one that really didn't succeed, he became an athletic director. But the Arkansas team, whether it's attributed to what happened, they actually had a team good enough, they felt, to win the NCAA. They really felt that they were strong, and then they pulled out. And the story, as it went on, one of them committed suicide, and one of them was an alcoholic for the rest of his life, which may have been a traumatic experience that resulted. And the opposite result, of course, was the springboard for one of the greatest stories ever in the history of sport, and these gentlemen are representative of it. Bob Lewis, the briefcase, the missing train tickets.
You want the story?
Yes!
Well, we're going to a taxi in Chicago, and Keith Brown thought I would be a reasonably safe person to leave a briefcase with all of our train tickets, so he told us he left them in the taxi. And we had to change train stations, and this was a Sunday. There were no ways for Keith, who tried to reach Ned Irish in New York and everybody else, to see if we could get tickets.
And there were 8,000 yellow cabs in Chicago.
And we were lucky enough that the last resort, I think, and Keith knows the story better than I do, because that was part of his headaches. He went out and looked, and a taxi guy came by and said, did some tall guys have this in a cab? And it was a briefcase and a ticket.
They went from Kansas City to Chicago, and that's when the tickets were lost in Chicago, and the second leg was going on to New York City. The tickets were 18 inches long, because they were just coupon after coupon after coupon, and he found some skinny kids hanging around the train station and knew those were the ones that belonged to the tickets, but it almost didn't make it. And talk about your tennis prowess. What was the story with Pancho?
Well, I was lucky enough to beat him in one tournament on clay, and so he returned the favor the next week on asphalt and beat me. But Rick Warner and I went to the NCAA semifinals in tennis that year and lost a five-setter. We could have got to the finals if we played a little bit better. But. So one of the interesting things I think about the team is that each of the persons that played basketball was a good athlete in another sport, like Arnie in golf and the others that have played, and just about everybody had at least one other sport that they were pretty good at.
Well, they were good all-around athletes. Fred Lewis, any more twin stories? I understand that the NCAA and Vadel got you guys mixed up all the time. Did you ever get fouls that he deserved, or?
Well, it started out early, and when we were in junior high school, I used to switch seats with Bob and give the wrong answer on purpose. And they caught on to that. One time in junior high school, a guy held off and slugged Bob. My guy, I was watching, thought it was me. mixed us up a couple of times. I remember one time, Pete Couch came back in the dressing room. They were told, come on, take your stuff off. I didn't know what I'd done wrong. I thought
sent you to the showers.
Sent me to the showers, and he said, no, I meant your brother, so I dressed and went back in. But when we were playing in Colorado, it was the only game that Bob fell out at halftime. And at halftime, they looked quiet at me and just read the riot act at me. There was a snicker around the rest of the guys. They knew it. Was talking to the wrong Lewis. I think the best is, you know, you varsity because the newspaper got it mixed up and had my name instead of mine. So we've had a lot of fun with the twin.
Fred, they mentioned that they happen to be proficient in another sport, but Fred happens to be proficient as a poet. And he's written this poem that everybody on the team is going to get a copy of. And it's called Captain Fred Sheffield. There was a young lad from the farm who would never do anyone harm, except opposing basketball foes who would dare to step on his toes. He had so much spring in his foot, he's in the high jump record book. He could tip in a ball in a hurry while his opponent was still in a flurry. As captain of his young team, he helped them fulfill a wild dream. When the going got rough in a game, with baskets to the rescue he came. In a scrimmage in New York, his ankle got caught in a torque. A torn ligament before the big game was bad news because it made him lame. After leading the team for a year, it was hard just to sit on his rear and watch the man run around without his high jumper to bound. What might have been the score with a healthy chef on the floor? Can't help but think the stats wouldn't have been as close as that. All the guys on the team want to say they were sorry Chef couldn't play. Well, Dr. Sheffield, what about that scrimmage with Oklahoma A&M in the YMCA located on some upper floor in some building in New York? What happened?
Well, that was the scrimmage that we had the day after the night we got beat by Kentucky. And what happened is that there was this, I don't know even though the YMCA gym in New York was a very small place, and you don't have any idea. You don't have any outbounds lines, you hit the wall. It's like when you sit in the old gym and they get the crowd on the feet on the floor, that's the type of gym. But anyway, we scrimmaged them, and I didn't think much about whether that's such a good idea or not. And in those days, I guess I particularly felt myself that we needed more general conditioning because we'd done the chain, I guess, for several nights, several days. No one got any walking or exercise. And the players never got much to shooting around. It's almost unbelievable. The teams do that nowadays.
So they
had to skip a Oklahoma A&M. And if you don't know what Oklahoma A&M is, it's Oklahoma State today. And they were the first team to make the change to the Big Center. They later on, I guess, in Minnesota with Mike Richard. But Curlin was 7'1". And he must have weighed about, I guess, about 240. He wasn't too fast, but he didn't really touch the day he could touch the basketball. He off shots. He didn't count the block shots. The block shots legal. So the only way to beat the Oklahoma A&M was to fast break. In that gymnasium, you couldn't fast break because you hit the wall and you're running out of court. So all that game was played under the basket. The type of game that Herb played, the defensive rebound. Now, as I recall that, I was on the offensive board. Two or three yards went up for the rebound and tip in. I must have come down first and then someone came down the ankle. The left ankle and it's quite a severe sprain. I tried to walk it off and play it off, but it's kind of carried on. Yeah. I never said what you could have heard. But Fred Lewis and I were talking the other night. I know it wasn't Curlin now because Curlin didn't jump. there's no way he could, but I think it was Herb coming down. Herb and I were teammates, but Herb was an excellent
with the bad ankle, you still jump soccer the NCAA.
But I went to, I didn't dream then, I should have known that I should have a game like there. I played for about 5 more minutes. And it wasn't the right thing to do, and I didn't put ice on it. Now they didn't put ice on it.
Why didn't the trainer come out and take care of it?
Well, the only thing with that is well, he had a trainer, Mr. Brown there, but we didn't even have any, the funny thing that gymnasium, we didn't have any water.
I had a box of Band-Aids on it.
Watt says that they had the same dressing room at Oklahoma A&M and that Kermit was bending over tying his shoe, and Watt said standing up, his nose was in Kermit's rear. A big player.
But Kermit revolutionized basketball and was doing the war, and it brought the high large center to the forefront. I think that's what people don't realize, how tough those teams were.
But it had to be traumatic for you, because here you are, this the kingpin, the center of the team all the way through the season, and you get to the NCAA tournament, the NIT, and you have to play Lane.
Well, I was not 100% from then on. No question about that. But the ankle, I did get to go to Kansas City, and I saw the trainer of the St. Louis Cardinals, who helped me a great deal. Got next to the told me a few things, but I got some dietary restrictions and a few other things. So I did get a trade from Kansas City.
Lucetti is credited with inventing the jump shot. How come with your jumping ability you never shot a jump shot?
Well, Lucetti was I never saw him play, but I heard his team on the motion picture. But Lucetti, I don't think was a jump shot. He just revolutionized basketball from a two-handed shot to a one-handed shot. This shot. I think that he's the first man that fitted to the one-handed push shot.
Did Vail let you shoot a jump shot?
No, Vail never did a jump shot. The shots that Arnie used to shoot, and I think Herb would walk, and Lewis is too, I guess they could all shoot it. It's a running jump shot.
Running hook shot, too.
Running hook shot. From any side, most times you shoot left and right handed. Use the hook shot, but you didn't pull up so much as you do now. You could stop and shoot quickly. You didn't use that shot. I wish I thought about it sooner.
Well, with Sheffield down lame, a young, I guess, 17-year-old freshman.
I was 18.
I'm talking about Arnie now. came into his four and became the third leading scorer in the NCAA tournament. He had 22 points in that championship game. And your game came together right at tournament time, right at the right time, didn't it?
I finally passed him the ball. I can't really see you up to that point.
How has the game changed? I recall watching that tape at your place, and you guys at timeout sat on the foul line.
It changed. During timeouts, the players could not go to the sideline and talk to the coach. I would suspect there's some James playing today who would rather not go to the sideline. They could give us an opportunity as players to sit down and talk about what we thought would work. And the coach really only got to us before the game and at halftime. But during the game, if you saw the film, we'd kneel down at the foul circle and we'd talk about what we were going to do and how we wanted to.
The only contact he would have, he sent a sub in.
Sent a sub in. Lots of times I wouldn't accept the sub.
Your favorite Vail Peterson story?
Oh, I have a favorite Bob Pasaka story.
Okay.
After we won the championship, and I feel this way about one. I don't believe that year in basketball that there was a more popular player in the United States. Bob Pasaka being a Japanese player during that war, and particularly in New York City. He was a favorite of the fans. And after we won the championship, we were invited on the Kate Smith show, the
commander of the Queen Elizabeth, which was a troop ship, invited us to go to the Queen Elizabeth troop ship to have lunch. As we got out of the cab and walked the block down to the Queen Elizabeth, all these barbed wires and sentries and everything, and we got about a half a block away, one looked at us and said, what do you think would happen if I yelled, Banzai?
Well, it certainly was home in Utah, because I remember, as I said, I sneaked in, and that was a great hero of mine to see him at Idaho. Back in!
One thing I'd like to say, I don't know that the story for the people that played just in 44 and then went on has ever been told. Watt and Dick and I came back and played at the University of Utah. But I think it'd probably be surprising if you people would know that five of us that played, four of us played professional basketball. And that was at a time when there were only 12 teams in the NBA. And the fifth one was Watt, who played, I guess, up to the next to last cut for the New York Knicks. And a tribute to Fred Sheffield, that he was a good enough basketball player that while he was going to medical school, the Philadelphia Warriors asked him if he would play their home games for them. Because of medical school, he couldn't travel with. Fred, the best job in professional basketball, stay at home, play the home
game. That's true.
So they really were, if you look today and see college teams, there are not very many college teams where four of the players go on to play in the NBA. And the fifth one had a pretty good chance to be good with another team like college. So I don't think people know that. They were great athletes.
In 1943 and 44, financial aid and scholarships were unheard of. And yet there was one player who was secretly on scholarship. And his fellow players didn't know about it. And it wasn't until later years, I was doing a story on Dick Smune, that it came out. And would you care to explain how that happened?
Jake, be careful. My son's in the church. We were thinking about filing discrimination for the university because the scholarship was secret.
This is my only claim to fame. The fact that I was the only guy on the team that had a full ride scholarship for 4 years. And I kind of used to rub their nose in once in a while. Just let them know, that they go top.
I thought it was because you were from Magna and he felt that no one from Magna could afford to go to college.
That could have been part of it.
Now, you almost didn't go to Kansas City. I mean, after the New York trip, you had a draft board asking for you.
Well, I was waiting for a phone call, and for about 2 or 3 days, and then I was on the way to Farragut, Idaho. On a troop ship. So, not a ship. That's where I went for my basic training.
I checked your celebration itinerary after you came back as the Golden Boys of 40. Kappa Kappa dinner, the Alpha Chi Omega dinner, and the Tri-Delta dinner. That was unusual. You were also treated royally in New York. Toot Shores, the Copacabana, the Kate Smith Show. Robert Hinckley of Utah was a vice president of Sperry Gyromatic. He put on a big gala for you. You guys were big time. I understand Pete Couch arranged a tour of New York for you. And you waited for the bus and he came down and told you it was a walking tour. After playing two games. Esquire magazine
sports writer got a hold of Mr. Brown and said he wanted to do a story on this team for Esquire magazine, and he said he could do the interview as long as they had the right to check the proofs. And when the story came back to him, they had Utah playing and practicing on outside dirt courts that sometimes turned to mud, and Coach Peterson came down from tending his cattle in the mountains with 10-gallon hat and cowboy boots. The story was never published because it was redlined by Mr. Keith Brown. He wasn't able to dig up.
I told you just the other night, this is my way to meet these guys. Who was the little guy that got up and said nobody had a story?
Well, it was the president.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Basketball history. The Golden Boys of the University of Utah, winners of the national championship as well as the NCAA championship in 1943-44. And gentlemen, we all love you. Thank you very much.
Some other folks that are involved, some teams and Fred. And we just want to recognize the basketball history we have. Our University of Utah has a wonderful history in athletics. And many times, this team and the basketball program and the arena we have today speak loudly to what a great tradition we have. And I think as you look through the 40s and the 50s and the 60s, we can all think of teams and players, and sometimes there's three and four groups of people that come to mind as we put together some teams and some wonderful things that happened. And as I looked at a couple of the players out here, I can think of stories that I won't bore you with, but it's really a wonderful tradition. I think we're here to celebrate that. I'm also here to really find out who was on the 1944 team. As the athletic director for 6 years here, six and a half years, I've met 27 people that said they're running me. And it's really nice to know that. It's also nice to know that, Monty, you must have been a really young child when these guys were playing. You're right, Monty, and I appreciate it. Ted Kinkner, my boss, who's the vice president here, also has reminded me what a young man he was when he watched these players play. Right out of diapers, I think it was, Ted, you told me. I also know it's interesting to look at the statistics here, Arnie, and find out that they only have field goals made, not field goals shot. That must be a nice thing for you right now to look at that and realize you don't have to worry about that. I was reminded of that Arnie was a fine player on that team, but they said he didn't pass the ball a lot, and not enough, according to Arnie, but people didn't sit with him tonight because they don't even pass in the rolls and never give it back. So he passed the ball, he didn't give it back. But it was kind of a fun team. But I also have in front of me a little bit of a financial report from that era, and it's kind of interesting with some of the politics that are going on in college athletics right now, this whole fear about a scholarship. And I look down here, and the tent per day, the whole team had $75 per diem to spend, the whole team. If you know my coach, he's kind of a big fella right now. He snacks a little bit, and his appetizers are about $87 per diem. So, you know, I get those receipts for me, and it's a little bit challenging. So I look at this, and the gross revenue was about $4,000 for both tournaments, and I thought that's kind of an interesting deal. So as we look through this whole thing and we see the trip expense of being $2,000, I wish I had the expenses of these and the income of today to run my program. I'd be a lot smarter about it. I think it's important just to realize that what we're here today is just a little start to try to get the best of all people back together and to try to have a wonderful event a year ago to celebrate 100 years of football and brought those people together, and it was just a great time. And just seeing the gentlemen on the team here and the camaraderie they have is very similar to what you'll see tomorrow night when you go watch our team play and the excitement that we have. And I think the sports can be overplayed, but at the same time, some people say it's a front porch to the university. And this 1944 team has been a wonderful front porch to the university in a lot of ways. And we refer to this team often, but yet at the same time, I think it's a symbol of kind of what can happen in the history of our program. So I guess from my standpoint, I wanted to just thank the players for being so good and giving us such a great history and for coming back this evening and for the people to support such a program. I know Bill really had a good time doing this evening. I think we do a lot of things in our department and we share a lot of things throughout the year. But yet this was kind of a fun thing, and I think Carolyn, Peter, and Ron L. from our Crimson Club staff should be congratulated and also recognized. And I just think that this history continues on, and it's a wonderful thing, and the University of Utah is one of the best institutions in the country, if not the best, in my mind, and the athletic program has started to mirror that a little bit, and we're hoping that we can continue to have teams you'll be proud of, and individuals you'll be proud of, because we're very proud of the people in this room, and I want to thank you, and I also want you to enjoy the game tomorrow night, and also give a big cheer for this team when they're out there at halftime, because we'll split us on more in the second half, too. So thank you for being here, and we have a good evening. Thank you.
LaRue Wright will be presented a medallion, a commemorative honor medallion as well, for her husband. And we'd like to thank everybody for being here. The dinner was sponsored by the University of Utah Athletic Department and Crimson Club. And the Crimson Club is a developmental department for the University of Utah Athletics. And I think that Dr. Sheffield wants to say something. He wants to come up and say something else. Go right ahead.
I'd like to say
hello
to my family. No, I just want to say thank you very much for all you people who attended tonight. And we really enjoyed the evening, of course. So, and then I think I say, Bill, I think you did a great job.
Oh, thank you. It's your job.
And I also want to make tonight thing a nice statement that championships are won by schools, but it's not necessary that particular year wins the championships. I think they're brought in the university by time. Members have preceded us, and the school, the teams have preceded us. We had, they had good degrees at the University of Utah. People like Merlin Malquist and Stu Pendleton and Hank Miller and people like, they just go back. My brother Val played for three teams in 39, 40, 41. 42, I guess, Joseph, Ron Bennion, Deb Smith. Those were and also, I had an extra privilege of playing as a freshman against the Wyoming team, Fulminich and Weir and Sailors, and they won the NCAA. So we're talking about first going up to the conference reputation and then building up the school reputation. Just to remind you all that 1942, Stanford won the NCAA basketball championship. Same thing we won. 1943, Wyoming won it. 1944, we won it. They're all Western teams. And most of the teams that were winning the championships in the 37 on when the NCAA started the NCAA playoff were Western teams, except for Wisconsin one year, and I don't remember which year it was. I think Ohio State won, but all the rest of the teams were out west. So basketball has only recently switched odds and extended to the ACC now. That used to be West, so I'm just saying that we participated in the experience of having all the other teams ahead of us, and being in the right conference at the right time, and having a group of athletes, dedicated athletes who were very talented. And it was a little luck involved, I suppose, but a little sadness in the Arkansas team, but that's the way life is, and we really took advantage of it. All the players on our team were great individuals and very good basketball players. So I just wanted to tell you all that we missed the two who passed away. But I want to thank you again for buying us all.
Done from WAC championship teams. We'll have 150 years by 20 years from now or 30 years from now, honoring you gentlemen as well. Now, contrary to popular opinion, I didn't broadcast the 43-44 game. But I did have the pleasure of working with Kobe and Mike Dunn. And what great pleasure all of you gentlemen have brought into all of our lives. What a marvelous evening. Good night.
Thank you. Good job. Who's in line? This time, we are pleased to make one of the most special presentations ever at a Run and Ute game.
Are they safe?
With us tonight at center court, our Ute Athletic Director, Dr. Chris Hill, and University of Utah President, Dr. Arthur K. Smith. Joining them on the floor are some Run and Utes we would like to honor for their outstanding accomplishments 50 years ago. In 1944, the Blitz Kids from the University of Utah became unlikely heroes when they defeated Dartmouth 42-40 in overtime in Madison Square Garden and became the NCAA national champion. Last night, some of these former teammates got together for a golden anniversary dinner with many of their friends here in Salt Lake City. Tonight, we are very proud to present them with a medal commemorating the 50th anniversary of that golden event. Unable to be with us tonight are Bill Gastelic and Mas Tatsuno, and we would also like to remember deceased team members Jim Nance and Ray Kingston, whose widow LaRue is in attendance tonight. Introducing Arnie Farren. For tonight's Rick Warner Chrysler Plymouth Frisbee Toss for a Car contest, our contestant will be given 10 seconds to throw three frisbees from midcourt. If they make any one of them in the basket, they will win a brand new...
Hi, Bart, Marianne.
It's now time for the Cellular One Domino's Pizza Fling. Cheerleaders will throw two frisbees
for Arnie. Nice hair, Bart.
To order a piping hot Domino's Pizza for the second half. Watch out, here they come, the Cellular One.
Chris, up the nose.
Darn it, Arnie, we are so proud of you, and you look like you're 22.
You did, didn't you?
Nothing injured.
you an 8-piece fried chicken dinner for just $5.99 at all Utah Arnies locations. Also, 7-game tickets are good for a free quarter pound cheeseburger with a purchase of large fries.